Hey, you know, listen, delighted to be with you here today. I always love to be with people that are investing in their leadership, in their leadership journey, students of leadership. And, you know, I have the honor to present to a lot of different audiences, you know, whether companies or associations, literally around the world. And so I've kind of become a student of presenting, you know, like what makes a great presentation? What makes it memorable? What makes it really effective? And I've come to the conclusion that the quality of any keynote, any workshop, is directly proportionate to the volume of applause that welcomes the speaker to the stage. So if you want this to be world class, you gotta do better than whatever that was you just attempted, okay? Here's Chester! Better! Thank you. It's a cheap trick, but you'll use that next time you present. Yeah, there we go. Let me tell you a little bit about my journey. This is my wonderful co-author, Adrian Gostick, and we have been studying leadership and culture for over 2 decades now, and it's really been wonderful to look at all the data and the interviews, and so we have a database of over 1 million engagement surveys, countless interviews and case studies and so on. And one of the things that we found really endearing and really hopeful is that the common thread in almost every great culture, every great leader, every great team we studied was gratitude, right? And so it was kind of interesting, you know, we adopted kind of a metaphor, and that was, you know, that when you reward and recognize somebody, you give them a carrot. So I want this to be really interactive. I know, and so I brought some carrots here. Now, there was a limited number, so, if, you know, you gotta participate. So for the first carrot of the day, if the carrot is the symbol of, like, reward and recognition and gratitude, the opposite of the carrot would be what? Just yell it out. Stick. Celery is the smart. Who said stick? Raise your hand right here. The closer you sit, the better your odds. Give him a round of applause. So we, as we traveled, we picked up these kind of fun nicknames. You know, we were we worked in Bonn, Germany with DHL, and they dubbed us the Deacons of Dankeschön, which was kind of fun. The ministers of motivation, you know, the high priests of praise. Well, one of my favorites was we were called the Dalai Lamas of workplace traumas. That's very clever. But Adrian and I both grew up in Canada. Do we have any Canadians? Hey, where are you from?
Well, I was born in Lethbridge, Alberta.
Do you know my grandfather was the mayor of Lethbridge for 8 years? Yeah, why? My parents grew up there. You're right, he does, incoming, yeah. You know, it's so funny because Devin said it's a high-maintenance audience, and he was right. anyway, we both grew up in Canada, and when we published our book, The Carrot Principle, the Toronto Globe and Mail, which is Canada's largest newspaper, dubbed us the Apostles of Appreciation, which is total props, you know, at your high school reunion. So my brothers and sisters, here at the Culture Forum, I'm not here just to give you the numbers and the case studies. Oh, no, I'm here to preach and to teach the power of culture. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can you put your hands in the air and let it sway like you just don't care? Give me a little hallelujah. Yeah, it's going to be more fun if you participate. It's not that hard. Yeah, there we go. So we'll have some fun. We'll give away a few things, and hopefully you'll get one or two really good nuggets to take back to your team. Well, Adrian and I did a lot of research on what really makes a great culture. And again, a huge database that was made available to us by Willis Towers Watson. And it was a global study, which was fascinating, you know, Asia and the Middle East and North and South America and so on. And we put together what we call the all-in culture roadmap. What does it mean to have a culture where people really feel, you know, all in? Now, we're going to not go through everything here. We don't have time. And I will talk to you about organizations and industries that have nothing to do with what you do. And I don't want you to worry about that. I want you to think about what are the principles and what can I take back to my team. Fair enough? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So here we go. So we wrote this book, and we started it off with a really interesting story of a character named the Great Blondin. Do I need to turn this on, or do you turn it on? Tap, tap, tap. Tap. There we go. And so, you know, I love your haircut.
Oh, thank
yeah,
you.
Seriously.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, as Gary would say, we have the same barber. Gillette, yeah. So who was the great, have you ever heard of the Great Blondin?
I have not.
No, and your name is?
Dakota.
Dakota, okay. A great name, by the way. Okay, so the Great Blondin, was it Reese Witherspoon, Pamela Anderson, Marilyn Monroe, a French tightrope walker or a tight French rope, Barker, what would be your guess on this?
Let's go Marilyn Monroe.
Marilyn Monroe would be a good guess, but, you know, wrong. let me give you a 50-50 on this. It's not A, B, C, or E.
We go D.
D, congratulations. There's your book. Give it a big round of applause. Awesome, yeah. A French tightrope walker. Now, his real name was Jean-François Gravelet, and he worked in the circus tents of Europe. Came from actually an acrobatic family, and he decided it would be really fun to come to North America and open up, you know, a new market and a bigger market and so on. And so he said, "What can I do to, you know, create some buzz, get some notoriety?" And so what he decided to do was to go to Niagara Falls, and he stretched a 1,700-foot wire across Niagara Falls. You know the story, and he walked across the falls. No safety net, no safety cord, no nothing. And it did everything he hoped it would do. It was in all the newspapers, on the tip of everybody's tongue. In fact, it was so successful that every time he'd come to kick off a North American tour, he would go to Niagara Falls and he'd perform. Now, he understood in entertainment what we understand in business, and that is that you just can't come and do the same trick, you know, over and over again. You got to have new products and services, new markets, new offerings, and so on. So, you know, that's exactly what he did. He came back one time and he crossed the falls on stilts, which was pretty amazing. When, you know, he crossed it on a bicycle one time, blindfolded. The guy was amazing. But most often he'd show up with this little wheelbarrow and he would perform various stunts. My favorite was he stopped in the middle of the falls with his little wheelbarrow and he pulled out a kerosene stove and he cooked an omelet. Yeah, because he's French, you know, and he lowered it to the Maid of the Mist. Went crazy. Well, legend has it, June 30th, 1859, he goes to Niagara Falls, kick off the tour, and he starts working the crowd. By the way, 25,000 people showed up to see him.
Wow.
Exactly. In 1859, that's pretty much everybody in upstate New York, right? And he starts working the crowd, and he says, "Who believes I can cross the falls?" And they all cheered, "We believe." And, "Who believes I can cross the falls with my little wheelbarrow?" And again, they all cheered, "We believe." And he asked a really interesting question. He said, "Well, if you all believe, then which one of you will get in the wheelbarrow?" Yeah. And a hush fell over the crowd, right? You know, break eye contact, spot on my tie, tie my shoe. And finally, a guy way in the back waved his silk top hat and said, "Hey, I'll get in." Now, it wasn't just anybody. It was his best friend and his manager, Harry Colcourt. And the great Blondin stopped them and he said, "Harry, I appreciate you volunteering, but I wanted to prove a point. There's a big difference between saying you believe and getting in the wheelbarrow, right?" And we know this in our business, right? It's easy, you know, the interview, you get all the right answers. How do you know when they're really all in? Is it good times or bad times? It's the tough times, yeah. Are you willing to take an extra shift, maybe work through the holidays, take a transfer, get certified in something? And we know this in our personal lives, too, don't you think? Like who can you call at 3 o'clock in the morning, right? Who can you really call when things are really tough? That's when you know they're really all in. Well, as a tribute to Harry, the next time they went to Niagara Falls, he put him on his back and took him across, which was no small feat. They were about the same size. So again, we're going to talk a little bit about, are you all in and is your team all in? Now, obviously, you know, we've talked a lot about today about the culture is the leader and the culture isn't the leader, but the culture sets the tone, right? And so obviously if you can't answer yes to the first question, it's gonna be tough to get yes to the second question. So how do we get all in? We love to talk about great cultures and we try to model that and what can we do to replicate those great cultures? Well, one of the ones we studied, and it was great fun because it was at the original Hard Rock in London, right? Was the Hard Rock Cafe. Now, how many of you have been to the Hard Rock Cafe and had fun at the Hard Rock? Yeah, no, it's not for everybody, I get it, yeah. The Hard Rock Cafe is really an interesting, you know, concept, and we'll talk about it in a minute, but a personal experience at the Hard Rock Cafe. I used to work in New York City. We were in media. We sold commercial time and stuff, and, you know, New York, it's hustle and bustle, a lot of pressure. Every now and again, we'd say, "Look, let's take a break, and we'll just go to the Hard Rock, burger and a shake, a little rock and roll, and decompress a little bit." And the old Hard Rock was on 57th between, I think it was 9th and 10th, or 8th and 9th, and it was a small restaurant. Now they got a great big one in Times Square. And the configuration of the restaurant, fairly simple, lower bowl, upper balcony. So anyway, we're at the Hard Rock Cafe, and they put us in the balcony. And in the lower bowl, there were a bunch of college students celebrating whatever, finishing exams, getting ready for spring break, whatever. When this song came over the loudspeaker, I know what you're thinking. If I name that tune, do I get a carrot? The answer is yes. Okay, so see if you can name this tune that came in the restaurant. Oh, who said that? Incoming, yeah, good catch. Big round of applause. And the band is? B-52s, everybody knows that. So it's really interesting because while they were playing that, with the college kids, we had a good view here in the balcony, one of the college kids actually jumped up on his table and started to dance. And it was kind of funny because he was actually pretty good. You know, so I'm going to kind of divine the room here a little bit, and I'm going to talk to you, sister.
Oh boy.
Your name is?
Kara.
Kara. So, Kara, do you remember when you were out for dinner with some friends, you know, not the Hard Rock Cafe, and at some point during dinner, you jumped up on the table and started to dance. Do you remember that?
I actually do.
You actually do? That is awesome, because a lot of times you don't. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So what do you expect the wait staff to do in most restaurants if you start dancing on the table?
Tell me to get down.
Tell you OSHA violation, maybe escort you out, encourage you to never come back. Yeah. So what do you think happened at the Hard Rock Cafe?
They got on the table.
You know, it's so interesting. They cheered, they clapped, and his waitress jumped on the table and danced with him. I know, how cool is that? Do you think that kid ever forgot that experience? I never forgot it. It wasn't me, you know? See, not appropriate at most restaurants, absolutely appropriate at the Hard Rock Cafe because of the Hard Rock what? Culture. See, they believe that there's a little bit of rock star in everybody. Now, do you treat your patrons, you know, your customers a little differently when you look at them as rock stars as opposed to just hungry? I would submit that you do. And you know what she's thinking? Where's my carrot? It's right here. I know. Whoa, bad throw. There we go. Yeah, but give it up for the table dancer. Yeah, so it's a hire to fit, right? It's not, you know, the Hard Rock isn't for everybody. It isn't for everybody. When you get that fit, though, that people that want to rock out at work, it works great. And the whole experience gets better. Well, how many of you have filled out those engagement surveys? Yeah, pretty much all of us, right? And sometimes they're quite extensive, like 100 questions. And do you trust your boss? And will you be here a year from now? Would you recommend the job to friends and family? It can get quite long. Well, the Hard Rock Cafe wanted to do one, but they thought, you know, that's not really us. So they did an engagement survey with just one question on it. And the question was this: tell us why your job rocks. And be creative. So guys wrote haikus and poems and stuff and photo montages. And a couple of them did YouTube videos. Now, with their permission, I'm going to show this to you. Now, we shortened it up because, you know, we got a little carried away and we do have a time constraint. But to give you a little background, this guy is the dishwasher at the Hard Rock Cafe in Amsterdam, just to give you a little background on that. Now, as you watch this video, pay attention to the words he uses to describe his job. And we'll talk about it on the back end. Here we go.
I just want to tell you guys that dishwash is not really a dirty job. You know what I mean? I really have fun what I'm doing. I work like 3 years now, and I still like my job. I just want to show to the world that you can be a dishwasher and you can still have fun doing the dishes. I just feel free. I can be what I am. I love it. Let's go inside. Follow me.
When I walk on by, girls be looking like Debbie Fly. I pimp to the beat, walking down the street in my new the freak, yeah. This is how I roll, animal print pants out of control. It's Red Bull with the big ass bra, and like Bruce Lee, I got the clout, yeah. Girl, look at that.
Come on, give it up for the dishwasher. I love that guy. So I also brought the official all-in orange wristband. Everybody, ooh, ah. All the cool kids are wearing them. So for the wristband, what were some of the words he used to describe his job? What did he say?
Fun.
Fun. Yeah, we said that over here. Fun. Fun to, it was somebody probably here too. Yeah. Fun. I'm sorry. Pretty vocal this table here. Yeah. So anyway, do you think you'll be a little more productive when you're having fun? Yeah, come to work, have fun. And then what was the other one? Somebody said Free. Free to be what? Free to be himself. He doesn't have to pretend. I don't have to put on a false face. This is who I am. And then he used the L word at the end. What did he say? I love my job. You guys would have gotten it eventually. Yeah. There we go. And the guys in the back never get anything. So, yeah, there we go. So, yeah. So, I love my job. There was an emotional engagement at work. Now, it's really interesting. You know, I grew up in Canada. I've lived in New Jersey now for over 30 years. So, I want to bring a little Jersey into the house. You know what I'm saying, yo? There you go. There you go. Yeah. So that guy's job is, that guy's what? Like, what's that guy's job? He's a what? He's a freaking dishwasher. You know what I'm saying? Does that guy interact with customers? No. Nobody cares about the dishwasher until the dishes are
dirty.
That's right. And then he's like the most important guy in the room. My point isn't why I love showing you this, because he's the dishwasher, is who owns the culture? You do, everybody. The leaders do and the leaders don't. Remember you gave him? The leaders set the tone, but everybody owns the culture. And I want to ask yourself this question. Who's your dishwasher? Because I'm convinced when the dishwasher gets it, everybody gets it. I mean, that guy's in the basement rocking out. Think he gets his little bit of rock star and everybody? Yeah, so what do you think the rest of the house looks like? Do you think it's bumping? Absolutely. All because of the frickin' dishwasher, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, so a little bit of rock star. Well, it's interesting, that emotional engagement, I think, is so key. And I think nothing gets you emotionally engaged like music. Would you agree with that? Yeah, you know, how many of you listen to music or you know, when you're commuting or you're working out or going for your walk? Have you ever had this experience where like a song comes on, you got it on shuffle, right? A song comes out and it takes you to a specific place in time. Yeah, isn't that remarkable? Like that song comes on, you're back in high school, you're back in college, first love, first kiss, when the divorce was final, you know? Those seminal moments. So we're going to play Name That Tune. I got three more carrots. Not afraid to use them. Name That Tune. Win it. We'll talk about the business principle. See if you can name this tune.
Happy.
Got it over here. Incoming. Happy. This idea of I'm happy to go to work. The alarm goes off, and I throw my fist in the air and say, yes, I get to go to work today. Is that pretty much you, Brandon? It is. Excellent. Good answer. A lot of leaders here. The whole idea is, right? I'm happy in my work. My values align. I'm excited to come to work. Here's another one, oldie but a goodie.
I always love you.
Thank you. But that's not the right answer. That's what friends are for. So funny. Can you delete that from the recording? Because I'm happily married, and that would be like really bad. Yeah, that's what. That was, and by the way, that was loud. That was, yeah. And seriously, we just met. My point is this, is, you know, Gallup did this big study. The most engaged employees have a best friend at work. How many of you have a best friend where you work? Yeah, somebody, you know, not just a coworker, teammate, somebody's got your back, right? Okay, here's the last one. You'll get it in like two notes. I'm a believer who said that, and I love the goatee. Hey, Cameron, yeah. I'm a believer. Give him a round of applause. That was a good one. Now, we talked about generations. Who is the band?
The Beatles.
Try again. The Monkees. There you go. Actually, our generation, it was the Monkees, but that was Smash Mouth and Shrek, just to put the record straight. At any rate, I love that. A definition of a great culture, I believe what I do matters and I make a difference. I can connect the dots. I'm the dishwasher, but I connect the dots. Clean dishes makes for a better experience at the restaurant, right? And I always like to add at the end, and when I make a difference, somebody noticed it and celebrated it, right? That common thread of gratitude. Well, again, back to the roadmap, the core is engaged, enabled, and energized. It was a really good discussion about engagement, that you can have a great culture and low engagement and so on. So, and we did. We took a deep dive on that and said, look, what does the research say? What does the research say? Now, I've got a copy of Leading with Gratitude, and I want to give it away here. And so the research was one of the largest studies ever conducted in the workplace. I think this is going to be for you, sister.
Oh.
Yeah. And you know, it was begs the question, how large was the study? Now, hold this like a rock star. Here we go. How large was the study? And here's your question. Was it a two-year study of 300,000 people? Just say yes.
Yes, it was.
Yes! Congratulations. Good for you. Some of the questions just not that hard. Yeah. So great fit for the team, right? So all this research, we said, look, you got to hire to fit. You got to get the right values and everything. I want to tell you a story of a really interesting character. This guy's name is Chris Hatfield. The Canadians are not allowed to answer this question, but really a famous guy. And I've got a carrot to give away, and this is going to be for you. Your name is?
Susie.
Have you ever heard of Chris Hatfield? Okay. If you can divine by the guesses who he is, you win the carrot.
Okay.
You excited? Okay, good. Is he a biology teacher? Is he a fireman? Is he an after-school driving instructor? Is he an astronaut? A, B, C, or D? What's your answer?
Astronaut.
Yeah. Final answer?
Sure.
You're right. Congratulations. Yes, big round of applause. And the great thing about Chris Hatfield is he's a Canadian astronaut. I know what you're thinking. Canada's got astronauts. We've had three, okay? Nobody, and it's really interesting because I met him in Lethbridge. There was a big conference in Lethbridge. I got to meet famous Chris Hatfield, one of less than 200 people to take a walk in space. I mean, how cool is that? And if you're Canadian, that flag of this, like, that's our guy, man. Now, he did some really interesting things when he was in the space station. He had podcasts and webinars and stuff up for students all across Canada to get them interested in STEM, you know, in technology and so on. In fact, he had such a big impact that they put him on the back of the $5 bill. Yeah, everybody, ooh, ah. Like, you know, normally to get on your country's currency, you'd have to be like royalty or dead or both, right? Now, it's not officially Chris Hatfield, but we all know it's Chris Hatfield, right? Now, here's why it was such a big deal when they changed the back of the $5 bill. It wasn't that it was him. That was already a big deal. It was who he replaced. Hockey players. Yeah. You replace hockey players in Canada, you better be a big frickin' deal. You know? So anyway, here's Chris, and I want to talk to you about this team. Great team. So here he is. He's the commander of the International Space Station. Three cosmonauts, two Americans, and the Canadian in the middle, right? They trained for 12 years before they went up. Imagine, trained for 12 years. And it was really interesting. He said, you know, we had one of the most productive voyages up to the space station in the history of NASA. And it was really interesting because it was such a diverse group that the difference between the youngest astronaut and the oldest cosmonaut was 30 years. So generational differences, obviously language, culture, and on and on. He said, well, how did you bring that team together to be so productive? And he said, well, it was really interesting. We knew each other's stories. Isn't that interesting? Where did you come from? What do you want to accomplish while you're here? Where do you want to be 3 to 5 years from now? And really interestingly, that Chris, when he went to go train in Russia, he didn't stay in the NASA housing. He went took public housing, and he learned to speak fluent Russian. What do you think that meant to the Russians? You know, as Americans, we think, well, just speak English. You know the old adage that if you speak more than two languages, you're multilingual. If you speak two languages, you're bilingual. If you speak one language, you're probably an American, right? And so we expect everybody to come to us. And as leaders, don't we kind of figure that? Like, this is my view, should be your view. You should come to me. So anyway, he did all these things, knew their stories. He said, it's really interesting. We learned all the rules in space. And he says, you know, huge amounts of information on how to do this. And by the way, they envision everything that can possibly go wrong. Because if it goes wrong in space, you have to be able to fix it. And a lot of times, if you can't fix it, you know, everybody dies. Just a little bit of pressure, right? He said, but I'm convinced that the real success of our team came down to one unwritten rule, and you're going to love this, that every astronaut had to perform a random act of kindness for every other astronaut every day. Every day. Now, six grown men in a fairly confined space, right? So it was never anything big, and they didn't keep track. You know, I said, hey, did you have like a little, you know, chart and then put the star? You know, because you're in space, star, get it? And he goes, yeah, no, we didn't do that. So the idea was, you know, I'll clean up. I'll help you with those calculations. Let me help with the dinner and on and on. Now, here's the result. You know, it's all about messaging, right? It's all about communication. He said, because we did that, we never had a heated argument. No one ever lost their temper. Because what's the message when you're serving each other just a little bit every day? It's you're on my team, I care about you, I'm cheering for you. You know, I love you. And he said, more than anything, it was that. That common thread of simple gratitude. I love this, that it's the little moments that differentiate the best teams. That you take a little bit of time to find out somebody's story. You take a little bit of time to figure out what skills they want to develop, where they want to be, how can you help them get there. And those little things are not little things, are they? They turn into be big things. Well, I love leaders that assume positive intent. And this is one of my favorite leadership principles. If all the things I talk about this afternoon, if you just remember this, I think you'll be in good stead. Assume positive intent, because sometimes we can, you know, misinterpret the situation, like you might with this guy. And that's why I'm a dog person. Yeah, there you go. I mean, there's a guy trying hard. He's doing everything he can. I love this. Whenever anybody ever says or does something, assume positive intent. Because when you assume positive intent, it's all about solving the problem. When you assume negative intent, it's all about blame, right? Who can I blame? And everything goes south in a hurry. See, I'm convinced that 99% of people come to work every day and they want to do a good job. And they're going to try hard, and in trying hard, they're going to make mistakes. And that's okay. We can fix mistakes. WD-40, right? Learning moments. Make a mistake, what did we learn? And let's move on. It's so interesting. And by the way, this is such a great principle just in our personal lives, isn't it? How many times have you misinterpreted something your kids did, or your neighbor, or whatever? Because I honestly believe that it's a fraction of people that get up in the morning, and they get ready for work, and they say, you know what? I'm going to set a goal today. To screw up 3 times before lunch. Right? No, people come to work and assume that positive intent. It makes all the difference. Bell Helicopter, what's the first thing that comes to mind when I say Bell Helicopters? Helicopters, people, seriously, some of the questions are. So we got to interview Bell Helicopters, really interesting. They are famous for the Huey helicopter. You remember that from the Vietnam War and the Korean War. Really interesting engineering and everything. Well, when the CEO, Mitch Snyder, took over, they were on a steady decline. They'd gone from basically 20,000 employees to like 10,000. Their sales were down and so on. And one of the things they identified was it wasn't their engineering. Their engineering was rock solid. It was the design. People wanted more interesting design, right? And so what he did was he went out and he hired these designers from video games and sci-fi movies to design their next generation helicopters. And he put them in the same room with his aviation engineers. Mm-hmm. How do you think they took that? We're both engineers. No, we're not. You're pretend, I'm real. And they would have these just knock down, drag them out fights. Because, you know, the aviation engineers would say, look, here's the new design for the new helicopter. And the creative guys would say, oh, can you make it look like this? And they'd say, nope. And they'd say, why? It won't fly. Could you flesh that out a little bit for me? And so there was a lot of contention. Well, Mitch decided to say, look, we got to have some ground rules here because this isn't working, and we're betting the company on this, on better design. So everyone can ask questions, make suggestions, no dumb ideas, right? Let's get a lot of collaboration. Let's get a lot of communication going here. Secondly, challenge the idea, not the person, because it started to get really personal in that room. You know, you idiot, how would you even know because of your sci-fi thing, you know? And then I love this one. Listen carefully before responding. The power of the pause. Take it in, take a beat, and then respond, right? How about this one? Debates are an opportunity to find the best idea, not to ram your idea home. The best ideas have to win if we're going to succeed. And then I love this. No one laughs at a person. You can laugh at a joke. Nobody laughs at a person. You know, it's really interesting. A good friend of mine is a Buddhist, and he shared this philosophy with me, and he was very kind. He said, by the way, you know, you don't convert to Buddhism. You can be a Buddhist Catholic or a Buddhist atheist. You can be a Buddhist, right? And he said, the great Buddha said that every word that goes through your mouth should go through 3 doors. And the first door is it true? And the second door is it necessary? And the third door is it kind? And I think a lot of us forget that third door. World needs a little more kindness, wouldn't you agree? So with these ground rules, the conversation went from nope, won't fly to, you know what, that just might work. And they started to collaborate, and they started to ideate, and they started to get things done. And then this article came out in the aviation publication shortly after we interviewed, and it said, the title was, "What if Lamborghini and Tesla designed a helicopter? What would that look like?" And this was their new design. I know, how cool is that? Not sure exactly how it lands, but it's a helicopter, you know. A far cry from the old Huey helicopter. The FCX 001. I think they could have done a better job on the name. The point is they couldn't keep up with the orders. And it was because they had ground rules on how to treat each other, how to ideate, how to innovate. Great teams, right? Great teams. Well, it's so interesting that as we started to take a really deep dive on culture in general, particularly post-pandemic and during the pandemic, is mental health, right? If it's not the number one issue at a lot of companies, it's 1A. How are we dealing with stress and anxiety and overload and so on? Well, uncertainty is the number one driver of anxiety in the workplace. People need to know the answer to these questions. Where are we heading as a company? How are we doing? How am I doing? And do I have a future here? It was talked about earlier about, look, I'll leave if I don't have a place to grow. But how do I know where to grow unless my leader? It's so interesting. Very few people like to be micromanaged in their job. A lot of people like to be micromanaged in their careers. Don't tell me what I need to do day to day, but really help me get to where I want to go. Does that make sense? Well, let me share some numbers with you. Pre-pandemic, about 18% of workers said they had some kind of anxiety disorder. So say 1 in 5, right? Now, everybody has a little bit of anxiety. Anybody never been anxious? Just raise your hand so we know who the delusional people in the room are. So a little bit of anxiety can be a good thing. Get your adrenaline going, get you ready for the presentation to the client or whatever. And a disorder is it keeps you from doing your job. It's an inhibitor, right? Look what happens by 2021, 30%. Jumped to 30% and 42%. By the way, same numbers for 2022, give or take a percentage. Those are big numbers. Look at the workers in their 20s, 42%. You're starting to get close to half. And then retention, you hire good people, you want to keep them. 50% of millennials, 75% of Gen Z said they've left a job due to mental health. They left because of mental health. Now, why would they just leave? Why would they just leave? Well, we asked this question, and I got another carrot, just call it out. What percent of employees do you think feel safe talking to their managers about mental health? 2% is low. Zero would also be low. Are you in accounting? Sorry. 10. Who said 10? In there. Yeah, like that whole table has carrots. Give her a round of applause. Yeah. 10%. And that was kind of mean what I said over there. So, yeah. Your carrot. There you go. Yeah, so although it is funny because I was doing this in Italy with some bankers and one guy said, 20%. And I said, that's high. And the next guy said, 25%. That's why there's a banking crisis in Italy. 10%. So flip it around. 90% of employees don't feel comfortable. Why? Why? Why won't they talk to their managers about mental health? Embarrassed. Stigma. I'll be perceived as weak, can't take the pressure. There's a huge stigma still around mental health. So, we did that generational thing. So I'm a tail end of the baby boomers. And, my generation, our solution was, hey, just need to relax, man. And I just calm down, rub some dirt on it, get back in the game, suck it up, right? I love this quote. Never in the history of calming down has anybody ever calmed down by being told to calm down. I think the yelling helps, right? And it doesn't work with your kids either, does it? Just calm down. So what is the solution? Well, the one of the big things with particularly younger generations in the workplace is this idea of perfectionism. How many of you have suffered from perfectionism at some point? Yeah, you're all pretty much high achievers. I think all of us at some point, you know, it's got to be perfect, right? Really interesting. Remember in university, college, that we do these mock interviews, and they would say, what's your greatest weakness? You know, we'd say, oh, I just work too hard, yeah. I just refuse to lose, yeah. I'll stay all night. I'll never give up, you know. So the Simpsons did a great mock interview with Homer Simpson. You know, one of America's great philosophers, Homer J. Simpson. See what you think.
What would each of you say is your worst quality?
Well, I am a workaholic.
Well, I push myself too hard.
Well, it takes me a long time to learn anything. I'm kind of a goofball.
Okay, that'll do.
Little stuff starts disappearing from the workplace.
That's enough. Next. There's a problem with the reactor. What do you do?
There's a problem with the reactor? We're all gonna die!
Give it up for Homer, a little round of applause. For his radical candor, you know, and only in the Simpsons does he get the job, right? Well, the reason we wrote our book, Anxiety at Work, was because of Adrian's son, Anthony. And I've known Anthony since he's a little kid. Super smart, classic millennial in a lot of ways, and suffered from anxiety literally his whole life. And he challenged us. And he said, you know, how can you talk about a healthy culture if you don't talk about mental health, right? And so we took a deep dive. Well, he very much was a perfectionist. He says, look, you got to know the difference between perfectionists and diligent strivers, right? Perfectionists, a lot of times, if they don't think they can do it perfectly, they won't even start, right? They won't even start the job. And most likely to be inflexible. They have ridiculously high standards, and everything has to be perfect, and they can kind of drive you crazy. Well, we came across this wonderful story of Maria Callas, well known as probably the greatest soprano voice ever in opera. Thing is, she retired in her early 30s, which is really young for opera singers. And the Washington Post did an interview with her and said, Maria, why did you retire? Did you lose your voice? She said, no, I didn't lose my voice. I lost my courage. And here's her story. She was such a perfectionist. Everything had to be perfect every time, right? Rehearsals had to start right on time. If there was somebody practicing, she'd fly into a rage. They tell a story of her getting ready for a dress rehearsal. She's in full garb, you know, and she would come off the stage, and there was a ritual where she had her very specific blend of coffee in a very specific place. And she came off of the rehearsal, and it wasn't there. And she just lost it. Stormed out of the theater, across the street to the barista in full garb, demanding her coffee, holding a 6-foot dagger. You know, the opera is pretty dramatic, freaking everybody out. And it was one of those moments where people said, look, Maria, this is, you can't keep that up. And she did, she retired. She didn't, it stole her confidence, it stole her courage. Does that make sense? You ever have that feeling sometimes? Yeah, if it can't be perfect, right? Well, you know, Maria, or Joan Sutherland, you know, arguably the second greatest soprano, sang into her 60s. Loved to perform. Knew it would never be perfect. She loved to interact with the audience. And she had an ally. She married her conductor, and he'd make sure the pacing was just right and that the notes were within her range. And she enjoyed this wonderful career. So ask yourself, who do you want to be? You want to be Maria Callas? You want to be Joan Sutherland? See, because here's the thing. The difference between, you know, like, really great and perfect, the differential is this much. And yet the effort is this much. Right? As my brother would say, sometimes that juice isn't worth the squeeze. So what do you do as a leader? And this comes back to communication and managing your teams. What are the expectations? I don't need a 95-point, you know, slide PowerPoint with, you know, videos and music. I need a one page with 6 bullet points. And that's good. You know, a lot of times good is good enough. You know, perfect is sometimes the enemy of just getting stuff done. So be really specific, particularly with younger generations, as to what your expectations are. And give constant feedback, because when there is a lack of feedback, they fill that void, employees, regardless of generation, right? With rumor, innuendo, and fear. Well, if I'm not getting feedback, it must not be good enough. I'm going to keep doing it until somebody says, hey, that's great. Take a deep breath. Get some sleep, right? So check in the progress regularly. Team them up with other people on your team that have a little bit of experience. Here's how we get things done, right? So what's your role as a leader? Well, you got to normalize the conversation. You know, if you had 42% of your workers in their 20s came into work with a broken leg, you say, hey, we got to dig deep on this, right? Take everybody's skateboard away would probably be your first move. But if it's coming in with a broken leg, you'd say, hey, get some PT, take some time off. When you're ready, come back to work. Well, somehow when you say, look, I'm just overloaded, I just need a mental health day, we go, you kidding me? Right? So you got to normalize that conversation and destigmatize it. Say, listen, this isn't, because I'm afraid, right, if I tell you that, I'm not going to get the raise, I'm not going to get the promotion, right? You're going to label me as somebody who can't take it. And one of the best ways you destigmatize it, and it's not easy, share your story. One of our really interesting interviews was Nabila Ekstalaman. She was the chief people officer at Walmart. And she would introduce herself as a recovering workaholic. And she'd say, look, I've worked in some of the biggest brands, you know. And I was a perfectionist, and I was a workaholic, and I would work long hours. And it cost me my marriage, and it cost me my family. So I don't want that to happen to you. Now, she was sharing this in a large group. And she took questions, and one of the questions that I thought was really insightful said, well, easy for you to say now, Nabila. You're the chief people officer at Walmart. Would you have gotten there if you hadn't made those sacrifices? Because that's the rub, right? If I don't do it, I won't get it, and maybe it'll pass me by. I loved her answer. She said, absolutely, I would have gotten this job. It would have taken me longer. And knowing what I know now, I'd make that trade. Well, her sharing that story opened the floodgates. Now it's okay. Now it's okay to talk about
it, right?
Let me back up. The wonderful professor at University of Houston, who writes all this stuff about forgiveness, and her name is? Yes, thank you. Good wristbands for the whole table. Yeah. Brené Brown, you know, I sometimes just can't. Anyway, she made a big differentiator between, you know, what is sympathy and empathy, right? And there's a big difference. And she put together this little video. Listen up. See if there's a couple of concepts that speak to you.
Here and to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space when someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, you can climb down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, ooh, it's bad, uh-huh. No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with at least.
At least. So what are some of the concepts? What kind of jumped out at you? I brought with me, by the way, the official gratitude stone. Ooh. Ah. Yeah, if you answer, I'll just throw it to you. What were some of the concepts? I've been there. I don't know exactly what you're feeling like, but I've felt similarly, yeah. Just kidding. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, great answer. I've been there. What else? I got another rock. I love that you pointed that out, because I think that's the biggest message you can send your people. Because when we get really upset and depressed, what do? We pull back. And we go off by ourselves. And that's the worst thing you can do. By the way, how many of you have high performers on your team? And they never disappoint, right? Never miss a deadline, always stars. And what do we do with those high performers? Load them up! Yeah, right? We load them up. I guarantee you that your high performers are almost always your most anxious, because they put so much pressure on themselves. Be really careful with them. So how do you identify it? Because, by the way, your high performers, really good at hiding it. Really, never say no, always a smile. So take a look and say, what are some changes in behavior? Anybody can have a bad day, but if it's persistent. Somebody who's never late starts showing up late. Somebody who never loses their temper. Somebody who always turns in quality work. And you say, okay, something's going on. Now, whatever you do, don't do that last one. What's your name, sir?
George.
Don't, you know, if I'm worried about George, don't do that last one. Come and say, you know, George, I heard this guy present on anxiety. And you check all the boxes. You're anxious, aren't you? I knew it! What happens? They pull back even further, right? So what do you do? The language is important. We talked to these therapists, and they said, start the conversation with, I noticed. By the way, George, I noticed that you've had a tough time getting to work. You know, let me know, sir, something we can do to adjust your schedule. You know, what can we do? Because when you say, I noticed, your brain interprets it as I care. Isn't that interesting? I've noticed means I care. I'm paying attention. I know what you're thinking. Where's my rock? It's right here. Yeah, I care. Well, am I going to feel safe and talk to somebody if I think they care about me? Absolutely. So you talk about psychological safety. Raise the bar to emotional safety. Make it safe to talk about a really tough issue that 90% of your employees don't feel safe talking about. And the other part is, you know, we talk to these, we do executive coaching, you know, and they say, well, look, I'm not a therapist. I'm not certified to do stuff like that. I can't write a prescription, to which I would say, and that's a good thing. What do I do? Well, what do your people want you to do? The one thing, they just want you to listen. But see, because we're leaders, we've got the answers and we want to give it to them like right now. Before they even finish, you go, been there, done that, do this, check, 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 send in the next guy, right? Now, I came across this video and I know we've all had this same experience, whether it's at work or at home. See what you think.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head. And it's relentless. And I don't know if it's going to stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever going to stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing.
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail.
See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just, sometimes it's like, there's this achy, I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
That sounds really hard.
Thanks. Thank you. Ow!
Come on, ow. If you would just...
Don't!
Seriously, if you had that happen, no question, right? So look at this. Employees report being burned out are 63% more likely to take sick leave, more than 2.5 times likely to quit. But employees that have a manager who will just listen are 62% less likely to burn out. They just want you to listen. Just listen, right? So leading with gratitude. We're wrapping up. We're a little tight on time here. Are you still with me? Can I get an amen? Leading with gratitude, that common thread. It's the soft stuff that's the hard stuff. And I hate that this is a soft skill because I think it's a power skill. I honestly think it is. If you get the people skills right, everything else kind of gets better, right? And this is stuff your mom taught you. That's how you spell mom in Canada, right? What did your mom teach you when you were 5 years old? Remember to say, thank you, please and thank you. Clean up after yourself. You know, leave the place a little nicer than you found it. Don't push, don't hit, don't bite. Write that down, George. Still good advice. Yeah. This is my mom and dad, John Dalton Elton. They love Irene. Get a little applause for Dalton Irene. They love that. My mom loves that I show that, but she's recorded a video for you here. Little advice. I know, it's my mom. Here we go.
We're Chess's mom and dad, and we've been married 64 years. So listen up, for he's got a lot of things to tell you. And for heaven's sake, buy a lot of books.
Yeah, what she said.
Come on, give it up for Dalton Irene. So it's not a soft skill, it's a power skill. The thing is, how do you do it? How do you do it that's effective? First and foremost, do it now. You think you'll remember, somebody does something great, go up to them right away. Primacy, recency. The closer the gratitude is to the behavior, the more likely it is to be repeated, right? And we get it in sports. You know, you win the US Open, you get the cup, right? And the Olympics, or the Lord Stanley's Cup, my beloved New Jersey Devils. Yeah, it's been 20 years, I get that, but we still want it, right? And when do they give it to them? They're still in their skates. They don't say, hey, by the way, go back to that change room and take a shower, put on something nice, and then come back later. We'll pass them out. No, I want it. I win it. I want it, right? Messi, you know, the World Cup, that one thing that he was missing. A soccer god, right? Now, we're in the middle of the NFL season. We got a weird tradition in the Super Bowl and bowl games. The winning coach, the players do something weird for him. You know what that is? The Gatorade bath, yeah, boosh. Does the coach enjoy that? No? What does it mean? They won. Yeah, they don't do that for the losing coach. Hey, we lost and I'm all sticky. I guarantee you he's dreamed of that moment. He's dreamed about it. Means they won. Now, they do it right at the end of the game. You know, you can bet in Las Vegas is the color of the Gatorade. It's like, it's not a good thing. Anyway, do you think it would be as impactful for the coach if, let's say, 2 weeks after the game, coach is at the mall, you know, with his family, but a couple players are there, go, poof! No! No, it's at the game. It's on the field. Primacy, recency. But Avis Budget, this Carlos Aguilera, we got to interview, wonderful guy. He manages a whole bunch of people in Dallas, Texas, right? And he said, you know, you got to remember as a leader, there's a lot of good things going on. So often we point out, because we're the fixers, right? We're looking for problems. We're going to fix the problems. We point out all the things that are going wrong. He says, you got to remember the good things that are going right, too. I'm a big fan of rituals and tokens. So what he does is he puts 10 pennies in his left pocket every day. And he sets a goal to have 10 positive interactions with his people. He moves a penny from his left pocket to his right pocket. Simple. I challenge you to do it. I can't always be with his people. Somebody, it's a text, it's a phone call, it's a handwritten note. 10 times a day. It's not easy. It's a discipline. You know, it's a leadership skill. You can't make the time. Everybody gets 24 hours. You find the time. It's a discipline. And by the way, how much time does it take to text somebody? Right? You can do it. And he didn't know this, but the Harvard School did a thing on the ratio of positive and negative in the workplace. Who's a big reader and needs a book? Okay, you know, end table, you guys get nothing. I'm coming back to you, yeah. So it's really interesting. What do you think your name is?
Brooke.
Brooke. So Brooke, what do you think the ratio of positive and negative in the ideal workplace is? Is it 1-to-1, 1 compliment to every criticism, 2 compliments to every criticism, 3 compliments to every criticism, or 5? Like, intuitively, which one would you go with here? Just which is the biggest number on the... Yeah, congratulations. Good for you. 5-to-1. 5-to-1. 1-to-1 is negative. 2-to-1 is negative. 3-to-1 is neutral. 4-5. You get it. You get it, right? What is your ratio? And by the way, take this home. What's your ratio with your kids? What's your ratio with your partner, your wife, your spouse? It's 5-to-1. Negativity is devastating. Yeah, you get on. Do you know on Amazon... Do you know how many 5-star reviews you need to negate a 1-star review? 20. And you've done it. I want to buy this at 5-star, 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 1-star, I'm out. Right? Right? And often, so let's do a little survey here. How many of you think you can get too much recognition at work? It loses its meaning? Just raise your hand. How many not enough? You can never get enough. How many of you don't vote? It's because you're Americans. Yeah. Just kidding. Just kidding. Funny because it's true. Anyway, I think in our personal lives we get this, and then we get to the workplace and we forget, right? So I'm going to ask you, you don't have to answer this, but I hope you do. How many, raise your hand if you want to participate. How many of you in your personal lives right now consider yourselves madly in love? Madly in love. Madly in love and happily married. Do you know, your hand really shot up just in the back. Yeah, could you come up to the stage just really quick? Give her some encouragement. Yeah. And we're kind of running out of time, so pick up the pace. Yeah. Okay, there we go. So, yeah, I think we get this in our personal lives. We get in the workplace, we forget. And your name is?
Lisa.
Lisa, and you are madly in love.
With my husband, Dan.
And happily married.
Very.
Yeah, and your husband's name is?
Dan.
Dan. How long have you been married?
28 years.
28 years, give it up for 28 years. So how often do you, or Dan, how often do you tell each other you love each other or do something that says I love you?
Multiple a day.
Multiple times a day?
We text throughout the day.
It texts throughout the day. So 365 days a year, multiple times a day, that's like, that could be like a couple of thousand times a year.
At least.
Yeah, that's too much. Yeah, no, really. I wrote the book. It was a bestseller. Focus, okay? Yeah. And it's not efficient. You know what I'm saying? It's not efficient. Like, I mean, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. You know, birthdays, anniversaries, Valentine's, that's just made up. Love you, love you, love you. Wouldn't it be more efficient if you just sort of had like a year-end banquet? Know what I mean? I mean, make it nice, you know, go somewhere nice, a little bottle of Merlot. And just, I mean, you really loaded it up one time a year. Wouldn't that be better?
Pizza party.
if that's your jam. Yeah. Wouldn't that be better?
No.
Why?
Because it's just consistent.
Yeah. And he's, you say, I love you. He says, I love you back. How do you feel?
Wonderful.
Wonderful. Yeah. And you like hearing it?
Yes.
Often?
All the time.
Because you're kind of high maintenance?
Very.
Yeah. Seriously. Yes.
Can't lie.
Yeah, no. I was just saying what they were thinking. Yeah. So here's the thing, and you can't hear it enough, can you?
No.
Oh, see, here's the thing. I love you. You can't hear it enough. I love you. I love you. Right? They've been happily married for so many years, right? He says, I love you. She says, they know what that means. I love you in your personal life translates to thank you in the workplace. Yeah. Don't get that mixed up, George. Yeah. Causes HR all kind of problems. So what do we have for you and your lovely his and her carrots? Congratulations. Oh, look at that. You're welcome. Yeah, big round of applause. That was awesome. Yeah, we get it. We get it. We get to work. We go, oh, I got so much time. I got so much time, right? And be specific. If you remember one thing, it's this. General price has no impact. That's different with them. They've been married for almost 3 decades, right? He says, I love you. They know exactly what that means. In the workplace, general praise has no impact. You ever had one of these managers? Hey, great job. Great job, great job, great job. You're number one, you're number one. You're the best, you're the best. Like finger guns just spray in the place, right? Gets very annoying very quickly, right? Specificity. What did I do that merited this reward so I can replicate that behavior, right? And then, you know, be sincere. People know when you're just checking the box, right? You know, send in Melissa. Yeah, you're doing a great job. Can you send in George? Yeah, he's next. Check, check, check. No. Be sincere. And by the way, you want to do something fun? Recognize the family. You know, I work hard. You recognize me. That's great. You recognize my family? That's family. Well, quick personal story. I worked for a guy named Kent Murdoch. Traveled a lot, and I'll never forget. I was at Dulles Airport looking for my connecting flight. And you ever been to Dulles Airport? Yeah, it's kind of designed for you to miss your connecting flight. Yeah. So we're solving some kind of, you know, customer problem, blah, blah, blah. And I close the phone, looking for my gate. Phone rings again. Caller ID, my beautiful wife, Heidi. The call you take no matter where you are if you want to continue to be happily married. And I said, honey, what's up? She said, you're not going to believe what just happened. She said, a guy came and dropped off 24 beautiful, long-stemmed orange roses to the house. And at first, I thought they were from you. I knew they weren't. Curious who they were from, you know? And see that note? It was from my boss. I just hung up with him. You can't make up these stories, right? And the note said something like this. Heidi, thanks for taking care of all the big things at home while Chester's on the road for us. The sacrifice isn't lost on us. Enjoy the flowers. All the best, Kent. Everybody. Aww. I know, right? Aww. Now, he knows we like flowers and roses in particular. Did he send her 24 red roses? No, that would have been inappropriate. Husband's on the road. No, we wrote a book called The 24 Carat Manager. 24 is our number. Orange is our color. Carat, I don't know if you checked up on the orange socks. Yes. Yeah. And the shoelaces. She is paying attention to you. Yeah, and the thing is, the socks are usually hard to find, but when you do, they're always on sale. Yeah. Those little things, right? Do you think that made a difference to us? Absolutely. How do you think it made me feel about being on the road for Kent? 2 thumbs up. How do you think it made my wife feel about me being away from home? 2 thumbs up. Because here's how the conversation ended, and I kid you not. She goes, Chester, where are you? I said, I'm at Dulles Airport. I'm looking for my connecting flight. She said, don't you dare miss that flight. Those are good people you're working for. You know, right? You know, and it was a wow moment. Now, I know you guys like to have fun. So next time somebody does something great on your team, just don't say, hey, great job. Why don't you go up and say, you know what? That was wow. It spells wow. This is mom. Yeah, this would be wow. Don't have a cow. Ooh, boo. You'll use that, yeah. So, yeah, it's a wow moment. And little things you can do. How many of you have ever received a handwritten note from somebody and kept it? Because it was personal and they took the time and you took the time to read it. You know, recognition, like nothing says I love you like Rolex. You know, a little Rolex. A pat on the back is different than a slap to the head. It's a spatial thing, you know. I did not see that coming. Well, if you want to make your day, go appreciate somebody else. Right? And that was your mom and dad taught you that, right? Better to give than to, because when you give, you always receive. Well, take it home. You know, all these principles work. A good friend of ours, he's got a tradition with his family. At the end of the day, his kids come around the table, and you've probably had this conversation, right? You say, how was school? Fine. What did you learn? Nothing. So now they have 3 questions. What was the best part of your day? Who are you grateful for who's not at the table? And who are you grateful for who's at the table who hasn't been thanked yet? It's a lovely ritual. My wife and I, no matter where I am in the world, we call it the end of the day. What are your three? What are three things you're grateful for? Lovely way to end the day. Absolutely. Well, this is my favorite number. Engaged at work, 150% more likely to be happy in their personal lives. Send your people home happy. Spend a lot of time at work. Make it fun. Make it engaging. Develop good relationships. Send them home happy. And I love this quote from John Wesley. Do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, for as long as you ever can. It's all about, how do you want to be remembered? What do you want people to put on your tombstone? Man, she could close a deal, right? Or best friend I ever had. You know, the famous Stephen Covey, he said, I've never met anybody on their deathbed that said, I wish I'd spent more time at work, right? And I love that. With the roadmap, we've got all the numbers and stuff, and prove it out. And the thing is now more than ever in such a contentious world, just a little bit of love, a little random act of kindness goes a long way. Here's a lesson we can learn from a little kid.
We end the week with Steve Hartman and what everyone can learn from a four-year-old.
He's faster than a speeding stroller, more adorable than a wet kitten, and able to get a stranger's attention with a single courtesy.
Excuse me?
This is America's latest superhero.
Don't forget to show love.
And the only superhero with the power to feed the homeless.
Now, why do you do that?
You know what, Mr. Steve? It's just the right thing to do.
Is it?
Yes.
You want honey?
By day, Austin P. Ryan is a mild-mannered four-year-old from Birmingham, Alabama. But about once a week, he turns into this alter ego.
Would you like a sandwich?
A superhero set on feeding as many homeless people as possible.
Thank you.
What's your superhero name?
President Austin.
Uh-huh. President Austin.
President Austin?
President Austin. That's his idea of what the president is supposed to do. I was like, buddy, you have no idea. But hey, I'm going along with it.
TJ says this all began when they were watching a TV show about pandas. It showed a mama panda abandoning a baby. TJ told his son the cub was now homeless.
He says, what's homeless? I said, well, it's when you don't have a home and sometimes you don't have mom or dad around.
I can tell what the follow-up question is going to be.
Yeah, are people homeless?
When I was a four-year-old, I didn't care about helping people.
I did.
I see.
Once Austin learned some people are homeless, and some are even hungry, he launched this caped crusade. Told his mom and dad that he wanted all his allowance and money they would spend on toys to go toward chicken sandwiches instead.
Oh, thank you, baby.
You're welcome. Don't forget to show love.
After he gives out each sandwich,
yes,
he gives each person that same bit of advice.
Don't forget to show love.
Don't forget to show love, he tells them. And most do, immediately.
Why, thank you. It warms my heart to see him.
It'll warm anyone's heart. Yeah, he really did, man.
Raymond Boss says this kid gives him hope.
That's where it starts.
Don't forget to show love.
Everyone who meets Austin leaves with hope. Which is why, with any luck, someday President Austin won't be a superhero anymore.
Being the homeless is the highlight of my life.
He'll just be a president.
All right, come on, Austin.
Steve Hartman, on the road, in Birmingham, Alabama.
Fantastic. Austin will be eligible to run for president in the 2052 election.
Vote for President Austin in the 2052 election. Yeah, give it up for Austin, isn't he great? You know, we've gone a little long. I just want to share two more concepts with you really quickly. I love to show you that video of my mom and dad. They weren't married for 64 years. They were married for 65. And shortly after that, my dad passed away. And he was my best friend. You know, he's my first manager, you know, taught me hard work and all that good stuff. And there's a picture of us. I'm 4 years old. He's teaching me how to skate. I was born in Edmonton, Alberta, where we say we've got 9 months of winter and 3 months of poor skating, you know? It's cold, baby. So we moved to Vancouver when I was 10 years old. We're a tennis family. And so I had my dad all to myself, being the youngest of five boys. And we had a tradition that we'd often go play tennis at the Vancouver Lawn Tennis and Badminton Club. And then we would go get a McMuffin at McDonald's for breakfast. And then we'd sometimes go to the Army and Navy, you know, the place where you get distressed inventory, 10 cents of that. My dad loved that place. It just closed recently, but it was in kind of a sketchy part of Vancouver called Gastown. So I'll never forget, beautiful summer day, I'm playing tennis, breakfast with my dad, and we're headed to the Army and Navy. We had to go by Pigeon Park, where the homeless people tend to hang out. And as we got to the corner, you know, a homeless lady was coming across the street with a big brown paper sack with everything she owned. And when she got to the sidewalk, it split open and it spilled. Now, it wasn't anything you and I'd want to own, but it was everything she owned. And Vancouver is very much a walking city. And as soon as that happened, people gave her a wide berth and kept me. She was invisible immediately to everybody but my dad. He knelt down, he gathered up her stuff, he said something made her laugh, and he escorted her safely into the park. Now, I'm a teenager at this point, and I'm watching all this. And he comes back, and I said, you know, Dad, you shouldn't touch those people. They're not clean. And he looked at me, and he said, Jess, you be good to everybody. Everybody's having a tough day. And, you know, you're here at this great conference, meeting all these wonderful people, and you go back to your teams and people that work with and for you, you don't know what they just came from. They could be worried about their kids, their parents, a million things. What you do know is the time that they spend with you, they can feel what they did mattered, that they made a difference. They believed in what they did, and you noticed it, and you recognized it. You see, it's all about a good minute. You know, my dad helping that homeless lady into the park, it didn't change her life, but he gave her a good minute. And sometimes that's all you need. Sometimes your people just need to know in that 1 minute that you cared about them. You asked about them. How's your mom doing? How's your boy? We can't all change the world. We're not all going to be Mother Teresa or Nelson Mandela. But we can give people a good minute and maybe another good minute and another good minute. And they go home feeling that what they did mattered. They believed in what they did. And you noticed it and you celebrated it. We can all do that. My last question. Are you all in? Will you take what we've talked about here this afternoon in the last couple of days? Will you take it back and will you actually do it? Not quite the response I was hoping for. As the minister of motivation, the high priest of praise, at the end of the sermon, the preacher asked for an affirmation from the congregation. What does the congregation say? Amen. Can I get an amen? Can I get a hallelujah? Can I get a wow? I say we are. You say all in. We are. We are. We are. I got a carrot. I got some red wristband. Hey, time is up. Thank you so much. This has been a ton of fun. Ton of fun. Time is yours,
good
my
job,
friend.
Good job, good job, good job, good job, good job. Woo!